Hello students, good morning all of you. This is your Prabhakar and welcome to our channel Dawn of Chemistry. Hope you are all happy and healthy in your homes. Stay home, stay safe. And in this video, right, see the name. This is very beautiful video I'm preparing. How to get 150 plus marks in NEET Chemistry. See, so far for 2.5 years, everybody is preparing for NEET. This is the crucial time. We are having 15 days of time, which is very crucial for everybody. 15 days of time we are having and it is very crucial. So this 15 days of time you have to utilize very properly and selectively. You have to study the topics, and if you get any nervousness in the preparation, means definitely whatever the work you have done for this 2.5 years will be going into wastage, and not wastage because that efficiency will come down. So that's why, so try to focus on what we are going to study, have proper plans, and try to write regularly. Practice test you have to write daily. One practice test you write daily. You have to analyze your score daily, right? One practice test, definitely it will help you to boost your confidence. So in this video, what I have done is, what are the important chapters we are having so far, and for which chapters are with most weightage and which chapters are with less weightage, and how to prepare them, and what are the different models of questions asked from each and every chapter in the previous NEET exams, and how the NEET is going to be in the next year, means this NEET, how the exam will be, whether it will be tough or moderate and it will be easy. So let us get into the things. So listen carefully. In this video, I'm explaining day wise schedule, and in the day wise schedule, not only the day wise schedule, for each chapter, from what topics previous year MCET, previous years NEET questions has come, and in the how they asked and how many types of questions, how they are going to ask you tricky questions from each and every chapter. The question itself will be looking very easy in the starting, but you will, it will definitely confuse you. That kind of questions also they have asked you in the previous NEET exams. So listen carefully to this video. Definitely it will help you to increase your preparation strategy. So let us get into the details. This is the syllabus what we are having in the first year, and then second year total. This is the syllabus we are having. In this syllabus, you see the left portion. This total is the first year syllabus, and this total is the second year syllabus. Let us see what are the important chapters in the first year syllabus and what are the important chapters in the second year syllabus. You know very well, we are having three portions of our chemistry. One is inorganic chemistry, and other one is physical chemistry and organic chemistry. Among these three, organic and physical, of course, though NEET students are weak, but they are not they are weak in physics, but they are actually not weak. They create your brain, my mindset will be created like that only, ma. So don't worry about that. Physical chemistry, from questions from physical chemistry will come very easy manner. Direct formula based only will come. One or two questions will be tricky. Anyhow, for everybody, it will be tricky only, not only for you people. So that's why physical chemistry questions easily you can do. 15 questions out of 15 questions, easily you can answer 30 questions from the physical chemistry. Organic chemistry, easily you can score 13 questions. And from inorganic chemistry also, you can score 13 questions in very easy manner. See, you may be, for everybody, the inorganic is the most headache topic, because they will be studying everything from the textbook. Don't worry, no need to study everything from the textbook. Let me tell you why. In the inorganic chemistry, let us say if they are asking you 15 questions, in this 15 questions, 5 questions will be based on the chemical bonding and molecular structure. Sir, why 5 questions will be from chemical bonding and then molecular structure? Means, let me explain. In chemical bonding, this is very, very important area, ma. That's why starting only I'm choosing this chemical bonding to explain you. In the chemical bonding, mostly the structures are the structure of molecules are very important. Let us take first A group elements, second A group elements, third A group elements, fourth A group elements, fifth A group elements, sixth A, seventh A, and then eighth group elements, D block and F block elements. So whatever you see, we have n number of compounds from every chapter of inorganic chemistry. So that's why, since we have these many things from every chapter, three questions definitely they will ask you based on the structure, based on the structure, whether it is, see, hybridization we have studied. Based on the hybridization, what is the hybridization of the central atom, how many bond pairs are present and how many lone pairs are present on the particular atom, and what is the bond angle, like that they will be asking you. Based on hybridization and based on the Wesper theory, you can definitely have three questions from this chemical bonding and then molecular structure. And you see, oxo acids structure and then sulfur oxo acids structure and halogen oxo acids structure and inert gases, xenon compounds are there. That is very, very important thing. If you see in the inert gases, we are having the xenon compounds, XeF2, XeF4, XeF6, XeO3, XeO4, XeOF2, XeOF4, like that n number of compounds are there. To understand every compound structure, there is no need to by heart. If you remember the Wesper theory and hybridization, aramse you can solve them. And oxo acids of phosphorus, oxo acids of nitrogen, and oxo acids of sulfur also, these problems, there is no need to worry about anything. I have made one video how to remember all these things. You can see the video on oxo acids part 1, oxo acids part 2, and then hybridization and Wesper theory. If you go through those four videos, definitely you will become strong in this chemical bonding structure, and three questions will be in your hand. You will never miss any question from them. And one question will be asked based on the dipole moments. This is very, very important thing. Mostly from the pattern, I am telling all these things. Dipole moments, if you see different compounds or dipole moments we are having, we can calculate the dipole moment. You know how very well how to calculate the dipole moment. Charge into radius will be coming. In these dipole moments, exceptions we are having. What are those exceptions we are having? Means if you see, alkyl halides compounds are there, methyl chloride, methyl bromide, methyl iodide are compounds are there, and then dichloromethane, monochloromethane, trichloromethane and carbon tetrachloride are there, and orthodichlorobenzene, metadichlorobenzene and paradichlorobenzene are there, cisalkenes are present and then transalkenes are present. So based on these things, dipole moment will clearly explain the boiling points of the compounds. If more is the dipole moment, means its boiling point will be more. So in these things, how to identify? If you know the dipole moment, means aramse you can compare the boiling points of them and you can answer the thing. So be careful with the dipole moments of this thing. And one more question you can expect from the molecular orbital theory. This is the very, very important thing. In the past 3-4 MCET exam, 16 17 18 19 and examinations, three times they have asked question based on this bond. This is molecular orbital theory. Be careful with the molecular orbital theory. How to identify the bond order of the particular molecule, how many sigma bonds are there and how many pi bonds are there, which molecule alone contains pi bonds in its structure, like that number of questions they have asked based on this molecular orbital theory also. Like this, since this much importance it is having, chemical bonding you study, means easily you can answer the most questions. Now after this thing, let us see in the inorganic chemistry what is the other most important part. See, classification of elements and periodic properties. If you see in this classification of elements and their periodic properties, mention this. You have studied all the groups, right? In the groups, every group you take in the starting, you are having the electronic configuration you have, general electronic configuration you have, for each and every element you have studied electronic configuration, and the trends you have studied, right, like atomic size and ionization potential, electronegativity, electron affinity, acidic nature of their oxides, basic nature of their oxides, and then oxidation states and the valency, melting points, boiling points, and all you have studied. And for every compound, you studied about their hydrates, you have studied about their oxides, you have studied about their halides and all. See, this is the order what we study generally in every group of element. We study the reactivity with hydrogen, reactivity with metals, reactivity with oxygen, reactivity with halogens and all. And again, we will take those compounds and we will write their bond angles, thermal stability, and all. Let me take you an example with halogens. Halogens react with hydrogen and forms the hydrogen halide. So we will study about the acidic nature of the halides, thermal stability of the halides, and their reducing nature of the halides, and all we will study, and their boiling points and melting points. Like this, trends are there. So the trends are very, very important thing. Like that, from the trends in the inorganic chemistry, based on trends only, their thermal stability. If you take first year group elements, means their hydroxides basic nature. If you take second year group elements, their hydroxides, carbonates, sulfates are present. Thermal stability order is there. Their solubility order is present. If you take oxygen family, H2O, H2S, H2SE, H2TE, their bond angles order is there. If you take nitrogen family, NH3, PH3, ASH3 and SBH3, their basic nature order is there. Their bond angles order is present. Like that, trends are there. Based on the trends, you can have three questions. Based on the trends, especially either maybe in the form of which of the following statements are true, which of the following statements are false, in that manner also they can ask you, or directly they will ask you which of the following is proper trend indicated above. Like that, they will be asking you number of questions. So if you can go through, see, I'm not including alone classification of elements and all the things into this one. I am including everything. Whatever the trends are present so far, try to have the list of all the trend. If possible, means in 2 or 3 days, I will make a video based on total inorganic trends, what we will be having, and I will upload. You can go through that video also. So whatever the trends are available on inorganic chemistry, try to study under the periodicity in the elements. Every trend you can write down and you can study. And whatever the structure, every structure, oxo acids of everything and halogens and resonating structures of them and the names of them, everything you study here, based on these two things only, you can have nearly 8 questions you can have. So in the inorganic chemistry, you got 8 questions easily from these two only. So this is the thing how they will be asking before whatever the competitive exams you take. Inorganic chemistry case, except advanced thing. In advanced case, they will correlate and they will ask in chain type of questions. That's a different scenario. Basically, NEET exams or local state entrance examinations or main examinations you take, majorly the part of questions will be based on the trends and the structures of the molecule what we will be having. And remaining part of questions, let me see how they are going to ask. The remaining questions we are having is hydrogen, S-block elements, P-block elements and D and F-block elements are present. Before going to them, let us see one more important chapter is there based on this inorganic chemistry, coordination compounds. This is the very, very important chapter. Why I am rounded off this thing means this thing you can expect a 3 questions around, 2+1 questions you can, 2 guarantee questions you can have, 1 will be coming or may not be coming. In this coordination compounds also, I will tell you the important points also. I have explained them about in detail during the schedule. I will explain that time. From coordination compounds, you can have 3 questions coming from them. 3 will be coming. So be careful with that coordination compounds also. And one more thing we will be coming is D and F block elements, P block elements, hydrogen, S block elements, and then P block element. Let me tell you one beautiful question how they are asking you. which of the following reaction indicates the oxidizing nature of the particular compound, like sulfuric acid, oxidizing nature of the sulfur dioxide, oxidizing nature of the phosphine, or oxidizing nature or reducing nature of the sulfur dioxide, oxidizing nature of the chlorine, like that questions they asked you. For that kind of question, simply you remember, simply find out the oxidation state of H2SO4. Or find out the oxidation state of sulfur dioxide. Normally oxidation means its oxidation number will be increasing. So if its oxidation number is increasing, means it is a donating electron. So in that case it acts as a reducing agent. And in oxidation reactions means it has to take electron. When it is taking electron, what will happen? Its oxidation number decreases. So reactions in which that particular compound oxidation number decreases, there it behaves as a oxidizing agent. Reactions in which its oxidation number increases, there it behaves as a oxidizing agent. So be careful. That model question regularly they are asking me. In 3 exams I have observed that question. So that kind of questions also they will be asking you. And one more thing, let us see. So one more thing what they are asking from these things is C. So totally from there 8 questions, from here 3 questions, and that is 1. So totally 12 questions we have covered so far, and hardly 3 questions are there. Mostly based on the reaction, very few questions they are asking. See, and one more type they ask is hydrolysis questions are there. So whenever PCl3 is hydrolyzed, what will be coming? The oxides are hydrolyzed, what will be coming? And whenever carbon oxides are there, second A group oxides are there, what happens when they are dissolved in water? So the oxides when dissolved in water, halides when dissolved in water, what type of compounds will be coming? So based on that they are asking you questions. And one more thing, let me tell you, some named compounds are there, like hydrolith is there, calcium hydride is there, and phosgene signals will be using calcium phosphide and calcium carbide is there. And whenever calcium carbide with reacts with nitrogen gas, it will be forming the nitrolim will be coming. And how can you prepare the pure nitrogen gas? Like that they will be asking you one question. So wherever there is a specific name for the particular compound, and wherever there is significance of that thing, they are asking one kind of question from those things. And one more kind of question they are asking is based on the reaction, directly they are asking you. So be careful with those things. And one more, let me tell you, during this your inorganic preparation, what you have to concentrate is try to study the textback questions very, very importantly. Whatever the NCERT textback questions are there, try to study all those questions from textback. Majorly inorganic questions will be covered from the textback thing only. So be careful with that thing. And let us see next how they are asking. One more kind of question is from hydrogen also, definitely one question is being asked. So from hydrogen, how they are asking questions means, we know very well hydrogen is having hydrogen peroxide is there, which behaves as oxidizing agent and then reducing agent also. So hydrogen peroxide, we have volume strength problems are there. Anyhow, we will study in the stoichiometry those things, that hydrogen peroxide structures and bond angles related questions there is a chance of asking. And when you take this water, hard water and then soft water are there, you know very well what is the hard water and what soft water, temporary hardness and permanent hardness. That temporary hardness and permanent hardness removal techniques we are having. Based on those techniques, they are asking the questions from the hydrogen. If you take S block elements, from S block elements, how they are asking questions means, based on the flame test, there is a chance of asking the questions. And you take the metals formation, the ores are there, you see. In this case also very important thing, ma. If you see here, metallurgy we are having, general principles in isolation of metals from their ores. So this is very, very important thing, ma. From metallurgy also regularly one question is coming. So what is the ore of particular atom? What is the formula of particular? What is dolomite formula? What is cryolite formula? What is the use of adding cryolite during extraction of aluminium from bauxite ore, that is Hall Heroult process. In Hall Heroult process, what is the application of this thing, and how can we extract silver and gold from their processes, that is MacArthur Frost process, like that they are asking you. And purification of ores are there, gravitational method is there, electromagnetic separation is there, froth flotation process is present, and leaching process is present. Based on those things also they are asking you the questions. Be careful with that. Which ores are purified? That kind of questions they are asking you. And after that, they are asking what are the reactions, what is the roasting technique, what is carbon reduction method, what is self reduction method, and purification of metals also they are asking some questions. In the purification of metals, we are having the zone refining technique is there, Mohn's process is present. You know very well, nickel reacts with carbon monoxide and forms nickel tetracarbonyl, that will be taken out and that is strongly heated to get the nickel, that is Mohn's process we call it as. So like that we can prepare the nickel also, and zirconium and titanium also can be separated by the vapor phase refining technique. So like that, based on which metal can be purified by which method, copper metals can be purified by which method, like that number of questions they are asking you. And one more important thing in this case is Enlingham diagram is there. One year they have asked you which of the following metal can be used to reduce aluminium from the alumina. Basically there is no metal, generally this aluminium is extracted in the electrometallurgy technique, but by using thermodynamics also we can apply, that is pyrometallurgic technique, by using magnesium we can prepare like that. So like this number of questions are being asked based on this general principles of elements. So if you observe this inorganic chemistry, so in this inorganic chemistry, hope your all fears got calmed down. So don't worry, my everybody will be thinking inorganic chemistry means I have to buy hard this, I have to buy hard that, like that everybody will be having that kind of thing. No need to buy hard. Of course some minimum thing everywhere you have to buy hard. And see this, like this chemical classification of elements and chemical bonding, you see they are particularly, there will be no much by hearting things, only that orders, you see every order will follow a particular trend, some exceptional orders are present, like ionization energy of the boron family elements, in the periods how ionization energy will be changing, how second A group elements will have as well as fifth A group elements will have more ionization energy compared to the other elements. If you take oxygen family elements, there they will be having change in the electron affinity order will be changing, and halogen family also electron affinity will follow a anomalous trend they will be following. So like that you have to remember the anomalies. And one more important thing you have to remember is inert pair effect. What is that inert pair effect, and what are the consequences of that inert pair effect? Those things you have to keep in your mind. So like this, max to max hardly 2 or 3 questions, or maximum 2 questions will be coming based on the reaction. So keep that in mind. Or mostly they will be coming based on the most familiar reactions only. Let us see, for example, sulfuric acid is there, preparation of sulfuric acid main reaction is present, that again we will study in the Haber's process reaction, Le Chatelier principle we will study there, and production of ammonia in Haber's process also we will study there, and Deacon's process is there, production of chlorine gas in Deacon's process, CuCl2 catalyst is used, that we will be studying in the catalysis process, H3PO4 on heating, what happens, it will form H3PO4, disproportionation reactions we are having, phosphorus reacts with NaOH and forms phosphine, and then NaH2PO2 will be coming. So there how the reaction is happening, that is a disproportionation reaction, reaction of chlorine with NaOH. Major reactions with NaOH are very very important one, because in halogens it will be coming, NaOH like universal thing, it can react with almost all compounds available for us. So that's why we can study about those reactions very easily. So be careful with the NaOH reaction. So if you can concentrate on the concept what I have mentioned so far, like coming to D block elements, and f block elements. Here lanthanides and actinides we are having, ma. In d block elements potassium permanganate is there and potassium dichromate is there. Their reactions are there. Those reactions again we will study in the redox reactions, in balancing of redox reactions. So that's why those reactions will be included there. And f block elements, lanthanides and actinides elements is there. This is the very very important corner from where there is a chance of asking question. If you see that lanthanides and then actinides thing, the lanthanide contraction based, they will ask you one question. Normally, as you move from left to right, the atomic radius gradually decreases. For ions only, it gradually decreases. For general elements, if you take europium, suddenly there will be jump in the atomic radius of the europium. From lanthanum to europium, it will be decreasing, but europium will have more atomic radius compared to the gadolinium. So why there is sudden jump means in metallic case the bond will be weak. We will be studying the metallic bond, so that's why it will be little longer in that case. So and hence europium will have sudden jump in its radius. That is an exception there. Those things you have to remember. And there oxidation states of these f block elements is very very important, and electronic configurations of these f block elements also very very important. So be careful with those things. So f block elements will be having the typical electronic configuration, so try to remember those things only. So like this we can close this inorganic chemistry. So in inorganic chemistry the major part we are having is what means you can have is these things only. Classification, trends are very very important thing, structures of the elements are important thing, coordination compounds are important thing. During the schedule I will explain the coordination compound. So let us get into the schedule. So this is the whole thing to reduce the fear of inorganic chemistry. Mostly everybody will be thinking inorganic is difficult, inorganic is difficult, I can't do inorganic, I can't memorize inorganic. So don't worry, if you follow the guidelines what I have given you, if you follow, go through the topics what I have told you, almost your inorganic fear will come down. Next let us see. Let us come to our plan. So what we have to do in the day one, what to do in day two, like that I have given some schedule. If you can follow that thing means definitely you can score better marks. So see, in the atomic structure what are the important topics means much questions are not being asked from this atomic structure, ma, because in your physics also you are having atomic structure, so there they are concentrating, so less they are asking, but still you see what kind of questions they can ask you. See, from quantum numbers there is a chance of asking question. Heisenberg uncertainty principle. From hydrogen spectrum they can ask you maximum questions. Electronic configuration, as I have told you during the finding electronic configuration of different elements, how they will be asking questions, and based on the photoelectric effect. And one more important thing is orbitals. In physics you will not study all these things, orbitals, what are the orbitals, what are the structures. Be careful with the radial nodes and then angular nodes of the orbital. That is very very important thing. Arrange the following in the increasing order of their radial nodes, decreasing order of their radial nodes, and all they will be asking you. So be careful with all those things. And you see in the quantum numbers, whenever they give you the electronic configuration for a particular electron, they will ask you what are the quantum numbers of sixth electron, what are the quantum numbers of the valency electron, that kind of questions they can ask you. In the hydrogen spectrum, you know very well, Lyman series, Balmer, Passion, Brackett and Fund are there. Number of spectral lines produced when it jumps from N2 level to N1 level, that is very, very important thing. In this case, the Rydberg constant is not same for all the elements. And you see in the Bohr's model, energy of the electron and the radius of the orbit is very, very important thing. Velocity is very important, and number of revolutions and the time period calculation also very, very important in case of this atomic structure. See, during the study of this atomic structure only, I have given you one more thing. See, classification of elements and periodicity in the properties. All these things you study in the day one of your preparation. Whatever the trends are present and everything, you study on this thing only. If you see here, the trends are electronegativity, metallic and non-metallic, electron gain enthalpy, ionization enthalpy, de-separation into blocks. And be careful with the IUPAC nomenclature also. Why I am telling is, new elements are there, like 111, 112, 113, 114 elements are there, right? The upcoming element, those upcoming elements can be named by using this IUPAC nomenclature. So they will give a particular element, it will belong to which group and which period, what will be the name of the particular element, like that they will be asking you. So be careful with this thing. Remember one thing in this case, lanthanum and then actinum both does not belong to the F block element. Lanthanum and then actinum belongs to the D block elements only. Commonly we will be considering them, or during, since we call them as lanthanides and actinides, will be mismatching, means misunderstanding will be coming, so we'll be grouping them into the F block. So based on that also one question has come. And you see in these things, based on the energy of the orbitals, they have given you in 1 year 1s, 2s and 3s orbitals are there. What is the energy order for them, they have asked you. For hydrogen atom, 1s will have lower energy, 2s and 2p will have the same energy, 3s, 3p and 3d will have the same energy. But for other elements, it will follow a different order. So based on that, they asked you one question. And based on the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, different forms. Normally we know that delta x into delta p greater than or equals to h by 4 pi. But in place of momentum, you can put velocity, delta x into delta v greater than or equals to h by 2 pi. And they have introduced energy term, and they have asked like that. They can change it into different forms, and they have asking the question. So be careful in this case. So like this, you can go through the preparation of this one. So from the atomic structure and from classification of elements in periodic properties, remember all the trends, whatever the possible trends are there, try to do all those trends and this atomic structure things here only. Let's moving into, be careful with the exceptions, that is a very, very important thing in this case. And after that, let us move into the second day. So see, second day I have taken chemical bonding and its structure. As I told you already, in this chemical bonding, formal charge calculation and all, just have an idea with them. Ionic bond formation, in this ionic bond formation, be careful with the Fasan rules. This is a very, very important thing. In these Fasan rules, how they ask questions means, which of the following is more covalent in nature, which of the following is less covalent in nature, and based on the lattice enthalpy also they will ask you questions. We know very well, lattice enthalpy is directly proportional to Z plus into Z minus by RC plus RA. So like that, based on the lattice enthalpy also there is a chance of asking question. Mostly the compounds of first A group and second A group elements will be forming this ionic compound, so mostly that's why their structures and their properties can be studied here. And the next thing you see, Wesper theory and hybridization, molecular orbital theory, and then hydrogen bonding. Be careful with this. 1 year they have asked based on this hydrogen bonding, which of the following molecule is capable of forming the intramolecular hydrogen bonding. Mostly cellulose molecules, they will have intramolecular OH groups and hydrogen groups will be there, so they will be forming the hydrogen bonds. Like that, there is a chance of asking questions based on the structure, lattice enthalpy, Fasan rules, molecular orbital theory, and then hydrogen bonding. Clear? Right. So this is what you have to do in the chemical bonding thing. Remember carefully, majority of the questions are going to come from the inorganic questions are going to come from the chemical bonding. How to find lone pairs and bond pairs? I have made a separate video for that thing. Definitely, if you go through them, means definitely you'll be confident. If you are new also to preparation, definitely you can understand. That much simple I made in my video. You can go through that thing. That is available in my channel. You can subscribe to the channel. So whatever the videos are there, at a place you can find those things. So go through that. Next thing. See, for 3 days, because of the importance level, I have kept this thing. See. Coordination compounds, differences between normal. See, means what is the double salt and what is a mixed compound or what is a complex compound. Like that, they asked so many questions. So how many ions will be produced, like that kind of things. There is a chance of asking questions. See, coordination entity, ligands, types of coordination, spheres, polyhedron, homolectic. They are the examples. If you see the Werner's theory, based on the Werner's theory, they have asked 2 times in your examination. They have asked 2 times. So how they asked means they will give you one complex CONH3 6 times, CONH3 6 times, Cl3, CONH3 5 times, Cl3, CONH3 4 times, Cl3, CONH3 3 times, Cl3. Like that, they have given you what happens when they react with the AgNO3. How many moles of precipitate will be coming? Even they can combine these complexes into the solutions also. In the solutions, we know that Van't Hoff factor concept is there. There, in identifying the Van't Hoff factor also, they will make use of this Werner's theory. So be careful. When it comes to the ligand, they will give you some ligands and they will ask you which of the following is bidentate ligand, which of the following is tridentate ligand. Like that also they will ask you. And next thing is nomenclature based things also they can ask you. But next, you see isomerism thing. This is very, very important. Structural linkage, coordination, and then ionization and hydrate isomerisms are there. For them, examples they will ask you, or they will give some complexes and they will ask you which of the following will follow this particular isomerism, or which complex given opposite to them is not according to the isomerism exhibited by them. Stereo, geometrical and optical isomerism. MAA2B2 type of molecules will be showing the optical isomerism. Let us take CO En twice Cl2, that will show the cis isomerism, and then trans isomerism. Trans isomers only will be optically inactive. Cis isomers will be showing the optical isomerism. So be careful with this thing. In the coordination compounds, based on the isomerism, they will ask you questions. Be careful with that thing. And here theory are there, that is inner orbital complexes and outer orbital complexes, or low spin complexes and high spin complexes. The ligand field strength order is present. That is a very, very important thing. 3 times they have asked questions based on the strength of ligand. Which of the following is strength of strong field ligand? Which of the following is weak field ligand? They have asked you. Be careful, or arrange the following ligands in the increasing order of their strength. Arrange the following in the decreasing order of their strength. And based on the magnetic moment calculation, mu equals to root over n into n plus 2. Like that, they have asked you, and they will ask you which of the following complex is colored and which of the following is not colored. They will ask you that easily you can identify. There is no need to by heart any complexer. Simply find the central metal atom. In the central metal atom, you see any unpaired electron is present or not present. Let us say, for example, FeH2O6 whole 3 plus they gave you. Find out whether it is colored complex or not colored complex. What you do means Fe plus 3 is the oxidation state. Plus 3 oxidation state means it will be present in the S2D6 is the configuration, so it will be D5. So unpaired electrons are present, obviously it will be colored, will be coming. So if you take ZnH2O6 whole 3 plus is there, find out whether it is colored or not colored. What you say? There definitely Zn 2 plus is there, means D10 configuration, no unpaired electron, so definitely it will be a no color complex will be coming. So like this we can explain the color of the complexes easily. Crystal field theory, ma, this is very important thing. Two questions they have asked so far, two questions asked from this crystal field theory. In this crystal field theory, what they have asked is they will split into T2g orbitals and then eg orbital. The distance between them is known as the splitting parameter. For octahedral complexes, it will be coming delta naught, and for tetrahedral complexes, it will be coming as delta T. So what is the relation between them? Delta T is equals to 9 by 5, delta O will be coming. That is the relation. Based on that relation, they will be asking you. Or what will be the configuration of the particular one? When strong field ligand is there, means they will be pair up in the bottom only, because pairing energy will be greater than the, less than the delta naught value, and hence they pair up down only. Based on that, they will ask you. And finally, you see, metal carbonyls and stability is very, very important thing, because nowadays they are asking in the very corner concepts. See, mostly during even your preparation of exam, NCERT exams also, we will not much concentrate on the stability of complexes. Stability parameter, K value, dissociation constant, they will give you. The inverse of dissociation constant is nothing but the instability constant. So based on the instability constant, they are asking the questions. There is a chance. And bonding in metal carbonyls, nickel tetracarbonyl, what is the structure? Iron pentacarbonyl, you take, what is the structure of it? Like that, they have asked. There is a chance of asking questions majorly from this topic also. So go through this properly. Ionization, the isomerism concept, you go through properly. Structures of these things you go through. Bonding in carbonyls, you have idea, but this concept is very important one. My stability of the complex is very, very important thing. And nomenclature also aram se you can do, and simple also, like this. And this basic terminology, anyhow, that will be nothing to do with that thing. They are very simple things, because already you have gone through them, so there will be no need to put some extra pressure on those things. So you can concentrate on these things to get the better marks, right? So that is the thing. Now let us get into the next day. So far we have done for how many days, means we have done for 3 days. We have given first day we have done atomic structure, classification of elements and periodicity in their properties, and the second day we have done for the chemical bonding and molecular structure, and the third day we have done for the coordination compounds. Since these are not memory based, these are technical terms only, so I have done them, and they are very important also. Every chapter there is a weightage of 3 questions. Chemical bonding is having weightage of nearly 5 questions when you consider all the structures and everything. So be careful with that thing. Let us move into the next day, electrochemistry. In physical, from electrochemistry, you can have 2 questions definitely. If you see in this electrochemistry, how they are asking questions means, let me tell you previous type how they asked means, from electrolysis, they have asked the questions. When fused NaCl is electrolyzed, how much it is, which ion will come and deposit? When 1 Faraday of electricity passed through the solution, how many moles of substance will be deposited? Like that, they asked 1 question. based on the relation between molar conductivity and specific conductivity. This is very important thing, ma. Why? Because lambda m is equals to 1000 into k by c when k is given in Siemens centimeter inverse. But when it is given in Siemens meter inverse, k by 1000 into c will come. As the units changes, the relation will be changing. That's why there is definitely chance of asking the questions based on that thing. So be careful with that thing. And one more important thing you can get here is Karasla. Only two questions, two models are there. One more they asked based on this electrochemical cell. They have taken the Daniell cell and they have changed the concentration of zinc and copper ions. Initially they have taken 1 molar and 1 molar, and after that they changed them to 0.1 and 0.01 molar, and they asked to find the electrode potential, and they asked what is the relation between the electrode potential, like that they have asked questions. So be careful with that thing. And 1 year they have asked to find the relation between Gibbs free energy and then equilibrium constant relation. So be careful with those things. So let us see what are the important topics you have to cover. Electrolysis, Faraday first law and second law, go through those problems. Definitely you can get questions, ma. In these electrode potentials, be careful with the electrochemical series, ma. See this electrochemical series. If you remember the electrochemical series without having any practical or problem solving knowledge, aramse you can answer the questions. If you see the electrochemical series, applications is top elements can displace bottom elements from their compounds. Top elements will have the more oxidation potentials, bottom elements will have more reduction potentials. Based on this one question they have asked, zinc can replace iron easily from its solution because zinc is having more negative reduction potential than the iron, they asked you. So see, zinc will be having more negative reduction potential than the iron. So more negative reduction potential they are mentioning. So generally you will be thinking iron will have more reduction potential than the zinc, but here they are mentioning more negative reduction potential, which is a correct statement. So like that they have confused that here. So be careful with this thing. And elements above hydrogen can remove the hydrogen from the respective acids. And one more important application of this thing is whenever two metals connected with one another, which behaves as cathode and which behaves as anode, that also we can easily identify by using the electrochemical series. Based on this electrochemical series also there is a video and mnemonic also, ma, within 5 minutes. In 5 minutes you can easily identify or you can easily understand what is this electrochemical series and how to remember the electrochemical series. So you can go through that and you can understand. And next let us see Navnest equation. Based on Navnest equation there is a chance of asking the questions. If you see primary secondary cells and corrosion, conductometric titrations is not there, it will not come. Secondary cells, lead acid battery is there. If you see the important thing in lead acid battery is, so in lead acid battery there is a discharging reaction and charging reactions are there. Pb plus PbO2 plus 2H2SO4 gives PbSO4 will be coming, plus H2O will be coming. Lead is behaving as anode, lead oxide behaves as a cathode. So this is the discharging reaction. 1 mole of H2SO4, 2 moles of H2SO4 will form 2 Faraday, 1 mole will form 1 Faraday of electricity. So how this is coming, they will ask you what is the discharging reaction and what is the charging reaction, they will be asking you. Be careful with those concepts. So in electrochemistry what you have to study means be careful with the laws of electrolysis, and after that conductance. Here Karasla is there, you see Karasla, be careful with the Karasla also. This year there is a chance, I'm expecting one question there will be asking from this thing. And after that conductance relation, specific conductance and then molar conductance relation. So go through these concepts carefully. Definitely you can have two questions from electrochemistry. And next let us see . So if you like this video means click the like button, ma. You want more updates from this channel means subscribe to the channel. Next you see stoichiometry. Why I have kept stoichiometry into this thing only means, see, this is also very important thing. I have encountered really two problems from this stoichiometry. Stoichiometry means not the complete stoichiometry I am taking. Here I am taking only the redox reactions concept into this thing. So see, in this case, oxidation number, this is the very, very important concept. They have asked you 1 year one question, HClO, HClO2, HClO3, HClO4, which is a strong acid they have asked you. You know very well, oxidation number of the particular acid central atom increases means its acidic nature increases. For oxoacid, that is the thing. Like that, for any problem from inorganic chemistry, they ask you like strength of acids are in which of the following, it shows oxidizing nature, which shows reducing nature. Directly they will ask you, Marshall's acid is there, Caro's acid is there, bromine Br3O8 is there. 1 year they asked you question based on the Br3O8. Which of the following is the correct structure of the Br3O8, they have asked you. So be careful with finding oxidation number of the particular element, because everywhere during inorganic chemistry we encounter everywhere about this oxidation number. Stability of chloride, lead chloride, PbCl4 is more stable or PbCl2 is more stable, means obviously PbCl2 is more stable. SnCl4 is more stable or SnCl2 is more stable, means SnCl4 is more stable. Based on the inert pair effect, the oxidation number will be changing. Based on that also they have asked you the question, so be careful with that thing. And next you see types of redox reactions and then balancing of redox reactions. Three times they have asked problem from this thing, so go be careful with this thing. So be careful with finding oxidation number. I have made a video, you can go through that video. Within 30 minutes of the video you will understand how to identify the oxidation number of any substance. That much simple I have explained there. So like this you can study your preparation. So electrochemistry and stoichiometry together I have added, because the electrochemical series and reduction potential and all will have relation with this stoichiometry. And balancing of redox reactions, you have oxidation number method you are having, and then half reaction method you are having. Any one reaction, one method you remember, that is sufficient. And in exams, simply some tricks they are telling you, see, find the substitute the given values and see whether they are balanced or not. They are more intelligent than you people. One year they asked you only for reactants only, what are the proper XYZ they have asked you. If they give you products and reactants means, then you can easily assess and substitute and you can assess. But here they asked you only for reactant. Whatever you put, it will be correct only. So in that cases, you be careful with this thing. And next, let us see. Organic chemistry, this is the crucial part, ma. So far we have done what is inorganic thing and what we have to do in physical, what are the things and what we have to do, we have done. Now let us get into the organic chemistry. In this organic chemistry there are so many things. First let us start from the starting. See, this organic chemistry structure, nomenclature, classification, see, types of sigma bonds. You see, the topic, whatever I have highlighted in the red color, from that particular topic, previous year questions has come. So that's why I have highlighted them. For previous things, I couldn't do. From now onwards, I have done. So you can, from this, you can easily identify from which topic previous question has come. IUPAC nomenclature, definitely one question is there. List of functional groups. Try to do problems with polyfunctional groups, ma. So whenever there is polyfunctional groups, there is very much confusion will be there. So that's why try to do the IUPAC nomenclature with polyfunctional groups. Definitely that will be helping you to get better marks. And you see types of sigma bonds. Be careful with this thing, ma. Finding number of sigma bonds and pi bonds. And one more important thing is, finding the hybridization of the particular carbon atom. So finding hybridization of the particular carbon atom is very, very important thing. So nowadays for every paper is having questions based on this finding the hybridization and writing the IUPAC name of the particular compound. If you see from the GOC itself, GOC means is not ordinary thing, total IUPAC nomenclature, isomerism, acidic and basic nature, reactive intermediates, reaction mechanism, everything is included in general organic chemistry, which will be giving you a definitely 3+1 problem possibility is there from this general organic chemistry. So be careful with this thing. From finding hybridization, definitely one question will be coming based on the IUPAC nomenclature. They will give IUPAC nomenclature of the compound and they will ask you find the hybrid orbitals, number of hybrid orbitals present in them, like that also they will ask you. And next you see conformational isomerism, which is obtained by rotating the carbon-carbon atoms. There will be no change in the bond lengths, there will be no change in the bond repulsions or bond angles also. That based on that they have asked you which is more stable for butane, cyclohexane, no need. For ethane, for butane and derivatives of ethane, like ethylene glycol is present. For ethylene glycol, mostly for butane, Gauss form, staggered form will be highly stable. But for ethylene glycol, Gauss form will be stable because of the intramolecular hydrogen bonding. So like that, they asked you questions based on conformational isomerism also. So that is the thing. Now let us see the other things. See, the other things we are having is geometrical isomerism, reactive intermediates and all. See, geometrical EZ nomenclature, cis and trans nomenclature we are having, tautomerism, RS nomenclature based on solid wedge formula. They asked you 1 year question. They have given you methane and they have given the position of hydrogens and they have asked you which hydrogen is above the plane, which hydrogen is below the plane. That kind of questions they have asked you. And reactive intermediates, carbocations, carbanions and free radicals. For these things, stability order is very, very important. Be careful. Primary, secondary, tertiary, which will be more stable. Primary, secondary, tertiary radicals, which are more stable. Carbanions, which are more stable. And this electrophiles and nucleophiles also 1 year they have asked question. So in which of the following electrophiles are, which of the following are electrophiles, which of the following are nucleophiles, which of the following are meta-directing groups, which of the following are ortho-para-directing groups, like that they have asked so many questions based on this thing. So these are the concept what you have to do from the general inorganic chemistry. Next, see, that inorganic chemistry is not over, ma. This is the further things in the inorganic chemistry. Sorry, organic GOC. See, carbenes, nitrines, electromeric effect, inductive effect and application. See, based on the inductive effect and applications, they have asked you questions also. 1 year they have asked you which of the following is plus M group, which of the following is minus M group. They have asked those questions. And be careful with the hyperconjugation means which are more stable alkenes and which are the less stable alkenes. So based on the stability of alkenes, they have asked the questions. And next you see types of reaction, solvent effect in polar solvents, in non-polar solvents. Basically it will come in SN1 reactions and SN2 reactions, the factors affecting SN1 and SN2 reactions. That time you will be getting these things. Here you see the major thing. See, acids, definitely you can expect one question either from acidic nature or either from the basic nature. So how they will ask, either based on acidic nature or based on the basic nature. So let us see. Acetic acid, trichloroacetic acid and trifluoroacetic acid. There are so many parameters are there which affects the acidic nature of the carboxylic acid, formic acid, benzoic acid, aromatic acids, aliphatic acids, phenols are there, substituted phenols are there. So which will be more acidic and which will be less acidic. So like that they will ask you number of questions. And for amines and anilines are there. For amines, if you see methylamine, ethylamine and propylamine, which will be more basic in nature, means obviously more plus I group is there, means it will be more basic in nature. But here gas phase basic nature is there and aqueous phase basic nature is there. If you take gas phase basic nature, means tertiary greater than secondary greater than primary will come. If you take aqueous basic nature, means secondary greater than tertiary greater than primary for the methyl substituted amines, and secondary greater than tertiary greater than secondary greater than primary greater than tertiary for the methyl substituted amines, and for ethyl substituted amines secondary greater than tertiary greater than primary will come. So be careful when methyl substitution is present, secondary greater than primary greater than tertiary will be coming. When ethyl substitution is there, secondary greater than tertiary greater than primary will be coming because of the steric effect and proton accepting tendency. And besides these things, anilines are there. Anilines basic nature is very very important. Aliphatic and aromatic amines, which are more basic in nature, means we will say aliphatic amines are more basic in nature compared to that of the aromatic amines, because in aromatic amines the lone pair involves in the resonance, so it is not available for donation. Even effect of plus M groups on the basic nature of the aniline, effect of the minus M groups on the basic nature of the aniline. So like that they can ask you number of questions based on these things. So be careful with these things and all. And one more important thing what we will be having is so this is the GOC. From GOC you can expect 5 questions completely, either maybe based on the IUPAC nomenclature, either maybe based on the hybridization. At least 4 you can expect, maybe based on the hybridizations, maybe acidic nature, maybe basic nature. Of course it is having relation with bases and acids that is present in carboxylic acids and then amines, but that and all will not come into the account thing. You have to consider total GOC as a particular thing. Even if you take stereoisomerism also will be considering for the special thing, but you can't decide like that. So be careful with these things. So this is the thing. And next let us see the another day stoichiometry. So how this stoichiometry we have to prepare.